Speaker and the coordinator for the What is Leadership Speaker Series. I'm super excited to be back in school and have this semester be another amazing speaker series. We have an amazing fall lineup for everybody. So if you've never been to a speaker series before, I'm just going to give you a quick overview of what the speaker series hopes to embody throughout the semesters here. So the speaker series is here to add to your toolbox of leadership skills. With that being said, there's no one way to be a leader. There's no one way to be a leader, and I'm sure you can find many, many books of how-tos and step-by-step process of how to be the best leader in American society today, but we all know that there's many facets that come along with leadership, and it's very complex and diverse, and the speaker series is here to bring people from all walks of life and paths of life to share their stories and experiences in hopes that you take away bits and pieces of it in your daily life. So it's not intended to be prescriptive. There's so many diverse leaders all over our world, and in this little dream world of Gunny that we live in, I get to interact with so many of those people each and every day and learn from them and grow from them, whether it's my coffee barista in the morning or little kids at the Whitewater Park or my professors and peers. You guys are all just have very different strengths within you, and I think leadership is about unlocking the potential within those strengths. So as a recreation and outdoor education major, I think the main thing I've learned from leadership is true leaders want to share leadership. And it's going to take leaps of faith and revealing some vulnerabilities, but bringing outside that inside passion that each one of you has or is growing as every day we walk on this earth, and sharing that with others is a great way to start. So I hope that everyone walks out of here with a new insight and perspective and gains a little bit about leadership and what it may be to you, because again, there's no true definition to work. A couple shout outs from people who have made this series possible and as successful as it is. First, the Recreation Outdoor Education Program for helping fund it and making it possible. 11 Experience in Crested Butte for sponsoring us. Brooke Moran and Mark Gibson, especially for this specific event. If you would like to help bring any of these legendary, inspiring human beings to the Gunnison Valley and specifically Western State, talk to me, myself, or Brooke Moran outside the table after the event sharing. Check out our archives and Facebook page and like us to figure out who is coming next and who will be here in the future. We're always open to thoughts and opinions on who you might want to come or how we can make the series more successful. I'm going to hand it over to Angie, who is the co-founder of the Casino Foundation. She'll probably pronounce it way better than I can. And works with Fara.
Hello, how's everybody doing? So my name is Angela Carroll, and I actually started out living in Crested Butte for a really long time. I was an educator for over 10 years in the valley, and also during that time fell in love with African music and dance and got exposed to this incredible world that I had no idea existed. I knew how much I loved the dance and how much I loved the drums. And then I went to a workshop with a woman from Zimbabwe happening in Kenya and realized that there's all these phenomenal teachers from all over Africa living here in the States and sharing their culture, Fara being one of those. So once I realized that that was here and accessible, I kind of dove deep into that journey and realized how much I love this particular music and dance and the culture, and started studying it more and more. And then I eventually traveled on a trip to West Africa and studied music and dance in Guinea, and then traveled into Senegal and ended up working in schools throughout Senegal. And when I came back to the States, I was very inspired, and all I wanted to do was study more music and dance and work in international education. And I've been back in the States maybe a month when I was handed a pamphlet with Fara inviting people to come join his ensemble, an intensively study music and dance with him, and also to help build a school in Guinea. So it was this divine where I was like, oh, well, this is what I'm doing next. So I ended up moving up to Boulder to study with Fara. I joined in his drum and dance theater, and then also we took some years working hard and started our own nonprofit, which is the KCDB Foundation. Fara is originally from the village of KCDB in Guinea, West Africa. And so it is such an honor and a pleasure to introduce him and have him here speaking in front of you guys tonight. He has been an incredible mentor and teacher to me. He's totally challenged me and pushed me physically in dance and music and learning all kinds of crazy choreographies and rhythms and all these things to do. And he has always been a leader in himself and the lineage line that he comes from. And his teacher he studied with pushed him into leadership roles. And by studying with him, he's also pushed me to enter these kind of leadership roles where I end up doing things like those, but public speaking is not something I love, but I've learned to get passionate about the things that you want to do and starting the school, building in Guinea, which Fara's going to tell you guys a lot more about, has been amazing. It's been incredible to watch Fara on his journey here. So inspiring as a teacher and as the fact that he's come, he's got his MFA at CU, watching him go through school and writing term papers while he's translating it through like three different languages, because English is what, like your eighth language or something. So it's amazing. It's been really inspiring to be working with someone that's, you know, going through these incredible challenges of like, you know, I'm like, what are you doing? He's like, oh, well, I'm trying to write this paper, but the way I'm trying to think about it, like first I have to kind of think about it in Susu and then move it to French and then translate it to English. And I'm like, wow, it's not that hard when I have to write a paper. So it's really amazing, inspiring the places he has gone to. He's a very motivated, powerful leader in all the communities that he's been in, within the African communities. So many of his brothers and sisters from Africa and he's been within ballets have always looked to him to be their leader. He has carried a lot of people, helped people to come here to the States, helped people to start really becoming greater teachers as he constantly is trying to improve himself and learn better ways to study and to teach and embracing all the Western culture and seeing how it fits with his traditional culture and merging all these things. And it's been a total pleasure and really an amazing, powerful experience to travel with him on that journey and to find ourselves finally having a nonprofit going and running programs here within the States and doing a lot of things. So I'm so proud to present Fara Tolno to you guys. He's an incredible musician, choreographer, dancer, human, and he's going to tell you more about all the things on his journey. Thank you.
Thank you, Angela, and thank you, Mark, and thank you, Western State, for inviting me to be here. Sometimes I'm just, you know, after they've been speaking, I'm like, how can I follow that? Because this is denim, the ins and out, the ins and out to be able to talk about it really well. But I'm so excited to be here, to be able to talk to you about my culture, about the Mandan Empire, about how that affect or how that fit into leadership in legacy. Because leadership, I believe that leadership and legacy go hand in hand. We have to have a leader to keep the legacy. Also, we have to have a legacy to keep the leader, training the leaders to become who they are so they can keep training other people as new generations. So, first, again, I want to say my name so I can feel like I'm comfortable to speak with you in your language. My name is Fara Tolno from Guinea, West Africa, and I came from the family of 7 people, and there's only 5 of us left. I'm the middle kid of that family, and my family years come from the Mandan, the people that have run away from the war to go stay in a safe place. So, Mandan. Mandan is known today as a country called Mali, West Africa. So Mandan is to be all the West African country that we know today. So those West African countries include Guinea, Mali, Senegal, Ivory Coast, Sierra Leone, Liberia, Cameroon, all these empires will be one empire. During the 12th century, 1230 and 1600. So the kings that we have is called Sunyata Keita. Sunyata Keita was a man that impacted the African culture in his way, how to help people to become a leader. So during his reign, Sunyata decided that, well, each member in the West African Empire needs to be put more emphasis on their culture. So as you know, in African country alone, one country alone, they might speak 38 different languages, or they might speak 48 different languages. So it's like when we take this, all these languages and culture together to put more emphasis in our culture to be able to represent it through the world and to keep our culture alive. So during this time, the Mande Empire was caste system. So caste system meaning that each family, if your family are a carpenter or a builder or a historian or a farmer or somebody that's a scientist or noble, so whatever they do, that's what you're gonna do. You're gonna follow that path. So to follow that path, to become a leader of your family, that one thing can make you take care of your family. So during this caste system, we have artists, we have musicians, we have people, actually those musicians being close to the king, because they have to be able to sleep with the king, to help the king be himself, to help the king attend, literally. So we call them the Jedi people. So the Jedi people are the people as the same bloodline. The Jedi people, we consider them as our historian, because they're the one who translate history from different sitting generation orally, without writing it. So as I'm speaking to you today, you can see Mande Empire structure of different countries. Not all Africa, but all this side of here, the Mande Empire used to be connected together. So inside of that, they have a connection with different families, with different languages, how people come together to learn from each other. So in the reign of Sunyata Keita on 1230 to 1600, he created this way where the families can come together, where people can be able to learn from each other from different places. So as learning from each other from different places, they learn each other's cultural custom. They learn each other's cultural music. They learn each other's different languages. So that's why when you go to West Africa, you might find one person that might speak five different languages, because they are sharing their culture with each other. They're helping each other to grow. So as a caste system also, if you become a leader, so you have to learn the ins and outs, the basic step to become that leader of the family. So that means taking the family ventures or taking the family legacy that they already have planted for you to be able to do, because that was kind of like the requirement. So during Mande Empire, we created amazing people. So one of the guys that I wanted to talk about, the story I wanted to talk about is Keita Fuliba. Keita Fuliba, he was an inventor, he was a playwriter, he was a scientist, he was amazing. So Keita Fuliba decided, as his family lineage, he wanted to go more in depth. So more in depth that going to school, learning about the Western civilization, because at the time, during the 1230 to 1600, we have the Westerners back in Guinea, or we have the Westerners back in the Mande. So Keita Fuliba decided to go more in depth. He went to school to learn French. As he learned French, Keita Fuliba got a boost to go to Paris. He went to Paris, and it's kind of like as a student abroad. Yep. Okay. I have to tell myself to breathe. It's like, breathe. I tell my student all the time, breathe. He's okay, breathe. You will find it. So Keita Fuliba, as a student abroad, he went to Paris to learn more the European culture, to learn more how the European do the culture there, that he can learn some knowledge to bring back home to his culture. So when he first went there, by graduating in music, he started his own company that's called Le Bain de Keita Fuliba. So Keita Fuliba went to Paris during 1938 to 1940. So during 1938 to 1940, graduating masters of music, so he decided to start his own company. So later on, that company became the Ballets Africains. the national company of Ballet Africa. So if I say Ballet Africa, meaning that the people, all the students abroad, come together to be able to represent African culture, to be able to represent the Guinean culture. Why? Because Keita Foriba saw the classical ballet during that time. Also saw how they put together the jazz music with the melodic instrument, because the instrument that he played is a 21-string harp style of instrument that's made with board. As he's a journey from school, I've seen that he decided to be able to create this company that will be able to help keep the African culture and legacy alive. So, during that time, they did a lot of tour in the Europe, in the Western world, and when we get our independence in 1958, Keita Foriba, the king at the time, decided to bring Keita Foriba back to Guinea. So, basically telling him, whatever you started back in Europe, you should bring that same knowledge back to Guinea. So, as I was saying before, Mandem Empire is a structure and caste system. A lot of the music that we play there, or a lot of the music and culture that we do have, is not representative, it's representational. It's a more traditional setting. It's more actually when things happen, then this happens. When there's a spiritual feeling, then this happens. So Keita Foriba, because he created that, the king just tells him that to come back to Guinea. And that king was named Sekou Guinea, because in 1958, Guinea gained their independence. He said no to the French colonizations, so we can be ourselves. And one thing that even in Guinea also is known as one of the richest countries in the soil, like everything that we have up there. But one thing that they have not taken away is our culture, the music and dance that we have in Guinea. So that music and dance actually become our envelope and passport to be able to share with people around the world. So Keita Foriba went to Guinea. They created a company to each different group, to each different culture, each different people of the group to go more in depth of their own musical style, each different culture to go more in depth of their own culture, to be able to bring that back in Guinea so they can be able to be more representational. So I want to show you a little bit of a clip of Keita Foriba when they come here in the United Nations in 1968.
Thank you.
See, I'm getting excited, I'm getting warm. So now I play the music, I'm getting excited. I'm like, okay, feel comfortable. But again, Keta Fodeba, 1968 in the United Nations. So this, like as I was saying, Keta Fodeba was a leader, a writer, and an innovator. Because to be a leader, you have to be innovative. To be a leader, you have to have a people that you work with. So not only as he's an innovator and leader, but he set the path of the West African culture or the Guinean culture to be able to set the path for Guinean culture so we can be able to study it and to keep that legacy back home in Guinea. So this 1968 foliage and the way it is and the present day what's happening in the Guinean culture is way different because this was the olden time as he set this path. That path come back to a main name that I wanted to talk about, Kenoko Sanu. So during this performance in 1968 at the nation, United Nations, this man actually was injured. He was injured. He's also a historian and a writer and also playwright. So this man take the legacy of what Keta Fodeba had started in 1942 as a student abroad in Europe. And when he brought it back to Guinea, this man take over to extend that legacy even more further. As I was saying, the Badass African was created in 1940. So 1940, when Badass African was created, Mohamed Kemoko Sanu was already part of it. He was a director of a choreograph, he was a director of the dance, he was director of the history, because we're taking the style of a classical ballet to be able to put it on the part, to be able to represent it in an African traditional way. So Kemoko Sanu was the director of the National Company of Ballet African. Kemoko Sanu was the founder of Ballet Merveille de Guinea. Kemoko Sanu also was the teacher of a lot of the famous drummers that we know, famous drummer and dancer that we know around the world today. He had taught them because he was the first legacy keeper from the Keta Fodeba. So some of the people might know about them, or some people don't know about them. We have Mamadi Keita, Famudu Konate, Bangoro Keita, Ismail Piate, Seguba Piate. A lot of these people are famous musicians in the West African world that keep the legacy alive. So Kemoko Sanu, what he did is like, okay, this Keta Fodeba brought this legacy back to us. Why should I do this? I should be able to have a new generation to come up so I can put my money, all my investment to the new generations. So that meaning that Kemoko Sanu take all his money that he made on his tour to bring it to all the different part of the, let's say, in Ghanasen or Prestige to give it to fund the new generation up there to learn their own culture. So out of that, we have great musicians, we have wonderful, amazing actors, we have all these people that become actually leaders of their culture. So I am part of that culture because I am the 13th generation of a Sanu's teacher. I'm 13th generation of Sanu's student that is keeping his legacy alive. Sanu is not here right now as a pastor. So this is one of the ways, also I want to show you a little bit clip, one of the ways that we pass the culture down in terms of a legacy to make kids become a leader. So this is Sanu before that. Thank you. It's not against.
Overagi
means that both make your legs out. So kind of put your legs out. From village to village. Before the scientist Grenville created telephone in 1868, we had a form of a message in Africa way back. So when things happen in the village, there's they play this instrument. This instrument right now is a small, but they have a different size of it. You have a big one, you have a small one, you have no small one. A lot of times you have a seven of them. As he was saying, when the creator made two sound, he said, how can I multiply this sound? How can this sound actually be able to talk with each other? So that's a crin. And crin was a sacred instrument from my teachers of village, from these people, the forest people, the people that come from the woods. This was not supposed to be out. But because as a scientist, as an inventor, as an innovator, as a creator, he decided to take this instrument here to put it on stage. Traditionally, this instrument is played sacredly because it's a sacred instrument for specific spiritual things, for rite of passage for cake, for rite of passage for their culture and their people, for their ethnic group. So Samuel decided to take this instrument to put it out, to be able to represent his culture because he was thinking about it differently. But this is the real story. When Samuel did this, his family, because this is Africa, something that we're not supposed to put out, if we put it out, that's sacred to the land, that's sacred to the people, when his son was missing. So when this son that was missing was named after our first king, which is named Ahmed Sepetue. Sepetue gave him like a gun. He's like, okay, go, people who take your son away, we gotta go find it. He went all the way to the state in Masanta and starts shooting. So everybody went away, like, but he still didn't find his son. Because he was an innovator and inventive, he took this instrument to put it out. As we're saying, you can find this instrument in many different parts of Guinea. But a lot of these people actually keep it sacred to their country. They keep it sacred to their culture. Yeah? So when we was doing a tour in Guinea. Sano take us to go to Masanta. When we come there, because literally people are scared of him, of everything that happened. People was like, oh my God, Sam is here. Oh, that guy, you take his son away. Oh, that Sam is here. People was afraid of it. So, and I wanted to show you, the one that I was saying, how we pass the legacy down from the older to the young and to the new generations. So this is one of the clips of that. So one thing also that happened in Guinea, when you are teaching someone to become somebody, you're giving them all your life and everything. Not only you are connected with them, but also you are connected with their family. You are connected with the neighbors, the people that support that person or that boy to come up. So you connected with each one of them that can be able to raise that kid. So speaking of Asano's legacy, that come back to us as the 13 generations of his student that he trained. So during our time, also things got changed, because when we come as a new generation, we come with new ideas, we come with new innovative ideas that help us to grow in these modern days, that help us to grow in where we are living. So, me, I come from, first when I learned about my history, about my family, they said I was a part of the normal family in the Mandeng Empire. We come from the village called Kisidugu. Kisidugu is a Malenke language that comes from the Mandeng Empire, meaning safe place. Kisidugu. Kisidugu. Because these people ran away from the war, during the war on the 12th century to 1600, to come down, stay in a safe place, to change their language and change everything. But my lineage actually was a part of the Sunyata Keita, the king that was fighting the Westerners to gain their culture and to become who they are. So as I lived here for a long time, I've been living here now in America for the past 18 years, as I lived here for a long time, went to school system here, trying to just be able to speak the language enough so you guys can understand me and be able to learn the culture from here in America. Because I said, if I have to live here, I have to learn the American culture. I have to learn the American dance form. I have to learn how to do business here. So I went to dance school, theater and dance, to be able to understand ballet, jazz, modern, the traditional stuff that happened here in America, how that fit in into my dance context, and vice versa, how that fit in into dance context of American. So when I graduated, I decided to go back to Guinea to go find more about my lineage, what's happening about my lineage. And I'm gonna go back, take you back again. Keta Fodeba is the Jeli people. They are the historian, the people that speak about you, about your lineage, about your seven generation lineage, who you are, where you come from. So my trip ended up being, I have to go to New York before I go to Guinea. So when I go to New York, I have a family of musicians up there that are JD, that are JP Fola, that are drum set player, that all have all these things. So the woman, it was older woman, asked me, what's your last name? And I told her, Paul, this is my last name. And she's like, do you know what's your last name mean? I said, yeah. They told me all along, I know my last name was to, you know, become a noble, you know, noble family, and we bring people together to spirituality, we just pray, we don't really drums, we just don't do anything. Yeah, so she's like, no, that's not your last name. I'm gonna call my grandma right now to ask her.